Well, this is our fourth week in our series on trust. It's hard for me to believe we've been in this now for a month. And up to this point, we've been laying some groundwork for where we need to go. We started out by explaining how important it is that we define our terms. We need to understand what we mean by what we say, right? And we said that if we don't define our terms, the world's going to be more than happy to define our terms for us. And we were talking specifically about faith. The world likes to dump us into the category of people of faith. That would be anybody that has any kind of religion at all. They just talk about us being people of faith. And that's not necessarily a bad thing, but understand that their definition of faith is probably not our definition of faith. And so when we embrace something, we better know what we mean by what we're saying, or we're never going to be able to defend our position. And so we talked specifically about defining, getting our terms defined right from the start. And so if you remember, we said this, biblical trust is what kind of faith? Do you remember? Active faith rooted in reasonable what? Evidence. That is so crucial. Biblical trust, we're defining it based on God's word, is active faith rooted in reasonable evidence. Now, we said that that's so important because the world is going to take that faith part and redefine it. The world is going to say that faith is something that you believe in and you have no evidence for. It's kind of like, you know, walking in the dark, leaping off of something and not knowing what's down there below you. It's not really anything tangible. Faith is just this empty kind of mystical kind of thing. That's what the world wants us to go with on a definition. We're not going with that. We're saying, no, that's not the faith that we have. That's not the faith that God is calling us to. God is calling us to a faith rooted in reasonable evidence. And what we said is that there are things that we can look at that are reasonable that point to the reality of certain things. And we looked at the idea of God. I mean, that's the most basic, right? Is there some reasonable evidence that we can say, we can look at and say, man, this points to God. This is a clue that God is really there. And so we talked about the idea of design. That as we look at nature, we see design. Design tells us that there is a designer. Then we looked at the idea of the moral law. In other words, everyone has the sense of a certain level of right and wrong. And if they tell you they don't, then steal their car and see if they think that's wrong, right? Everyone knows deep down there's right and wrong. There's a moral code. Well, if there's a moral code, if there's a moral law, that points to a moral lawgiver. And so we looked at a few of those things and we said, man, there is good evidence, reasonable evidence that there's a God. And then from there we talked about miracles. Well, if there's a God, if God exists, then miracles are reasonable. It makes sense that there would be miracles. And the greatest miracle of all, we said, is creation, that God would create. And then we said one of the greatest miracles for the Christian faith is the miracle of the resurrection. But see, if you have a God that could create from nothing, from no thing, he didn't have to use anything to make it, to put it together, because he's all that there is, or all that there was, right? Then for him to raise someone from the dead is no big deal. Miracles are possible. The resurrection certainly is possible. And then last week, Clinton took us through the idea that if all that evidence points to those things, is there evidence that points to the idea that the New Testament is reliable? And what we saw is, yeah, there's a lot of good evidence that points to the fact that the book that we hold in our hands is reliable. So we've got these reasonable evidences, right, for our faith. Reasonable evidence is rooted in these things. We can see that, man, evidence points to the fact that there's a God. Evidence points to the fact that miracles are possible. Evidence points to the idea that the New Testament is reliable. So we're good to go, right? No, because remember, our study is on trust. We say, wait a minute, I thought faith and trust are the same thing. No, they're not. They're related to each other, but they're not the same thing. Remember, we talked about the idea that they're almost like two sides of a coin. Faith is the noun. Remember, it's something I possess. Trust is the action. It's the verb. So I can have faith that's rooted in evidence, but not be actively trusting. And you know what kind of faith you have? If you have faith rooted in evidence, but it doesn't act, you know what kind of faith you have? Well, let me tell you what Scripture says. The Bible says that if you have that kind of faith, it's dead faith. Take a look at James chapter 2. Let me show you what it says right here in Scripture. James chapter 2, verse 14. Listen to what he writes here. What good is it, dear brothers and sisters, if you say you have faith, but don't show it by your actions? Can that kind of faith save anyone? Suppose you see a brother or sister who has no food or clothing, and you say, goodbye and have a good day, stay warm and eat well, but then you don't give that person any food or clothing. What good does that do? So you see, faith by itself isn't enough. Unless it produces good deeds, it is dead and useless. Now, someone may argue, some people have faith, others have good deeds. But I say, how can you show me your faith if you don't have good deeds? I will show you my faith by my good deeds. You say you have faith, for you believe that there is one God? Good for you. Even the demons believe this, and they tremble in terror. How foolish. Can't you see that faith without good deeds is useless? Folks, that is just a sobering passage, because what that says is that you can claim all you want that you have faith, but true faith is the opposite side of the coin, where trust is on the other. True faith is faith in action. It's a faith that works itself out in trust. And if you say you have faith, but you have no trusting actions, that faith that you claim is a useless faith. That is some scary stuff. Because here's what we have. We can have a bunch of people that say, I believe that there's a God. I believe that there's reasonable evidence that there's a God. I believe since there's a God, miracles are possible. And I believe since miracles are possible that Jesus could have risen from the dead. And I believe even that this Bible is reliable. But they never act on it. According to this passage, that is a dead faith. That's so scary, because what happens is you have a lot of people, and by the way, Jesus said this. He said it like this. He said, many will say on that day when they stand before him, Lord, Lord. And he'll look at them and say, depart from me. I don't know who you are. See, what this passage is saying is that there couldn't be a lot of people to say, I believe, I believe, I believe. But there's no activity, there's no action that demonstrates that they believe. And that is a useless, dead faith. Now, don't misunderstand. We don't work for our salvation. You can never earn grace. It doesn't work that way. Salvation is a gift from God. What it means, though, is if I understand what God has done and I accept that grace, I will have actions that will demonstrate that I believe that. That's what that's talking about. So just because we've gone through the reasonable evidence, it doesn't mean we're done. In some ways, we've really just begun. Because now it's time for us to work out the faith that we say we have. See, trust is the outworking of our faith. You go, whoa, wait a minute. So then, how can I do this? If trust is working at my faith, how can I learn to do this? And I want to talk about three ways this morning that you and I can learn to trust God. Three ways that we can learn to act out our faith. So if you have your notes this morning, here's the very first one. You can learn to trust God as you get to know Him. See, trust is built on knowledge. I need to gather information about this God that will show me if He is trustworthy. See, it's one thing to believe that He's there. I have reasonable evidence to believe that there is a God. It's another thing to trust Him, right? And so the way that I grow and learn how to trust Him is to get to know Him. I mean, that makes sense, right? Listen to Psalm 9:10. I think it's in your notes. Those who know your name trust in you. For you, O Lord, do not abandon those who search for you. See, here's the first thing we need to know about God. We need to know His name. Would you put that down? Know His name. The psalmist says, those who know your name, what? Trust in you. See, the idea of knowing a name, it's kind of lost things for us. For us, now names are just labels. We look at, hey, do you know that guy's name? What are we saying? Do you know his label? But see, back in the day, a name was very significant. A name wasn't just a label. A name told you something about the person. And so when the psalmist says, those who know your name, it's talking about the whole person of God, because in His name is His person. So you go, whoa, okay. Well, what's His name? Well, it's right there. Look what it says. Those who know your name trust in you, for you, O Lord. Say, oh, so His name is Lord. No, His name's not Lord. If you notice, if you have your Bible open, if you notice, those letters for Lord are in capital letters. That means that there's a name behind that word, Lord. And the name is the Hebrew name, Yahweh. Every time you see that in the Old Testament, capital L, capital O, capital R, capital D, it is to signify that the name, personal name of God is being used there, Yahweh. That's the name. And see, here's the crazy thing about it. We're not even positive that's the way it's pronounced, because it was such a sacred name to the Jews, they wouldn't pronounce it. And see, there's a crazy thing about Middle Eastern language. It used to be that they didn't have any vowels when they wrote it. It was all consonants. But the people were so familiar with the language, when they read it, they knew where the vowels were supposed to go. But after some time, it kind of got confusing. And so what they did is they did this thing called vowel pointings. And if you ever notice some Middle Eastern writing like Hebrew, there'll be these little dots and looks like T's and different things between the letters. Those tell what vowel is supposed to go between the consonants. But see, here's the thing with the word Yahweh. It wasn't spoken because it was so sacred that the priests would never pronounce it out loud because they considered it so holy. So we're not positive, but based on study and looking into it, we're kind of close to the idea that it could be this word Yahweh. It's used over 6,000 times in the Old Testament, God's personal name. It's an important name. In fact, one of the passages that really points out how important it is, and it gives us an idea of what it means, is in Exodus chapter 3. And if you remember, the people of Israel were slaves in Egypt. And Moses, he's out doing his thing, raising sheep in the middle of the desert. And God shows up in the form of this burning bush to get Moses' attention. And he starts to speak to Moses. He says, Moses, I want you to go to the Pharaoh, and I want you to tell Pharaoh to let my people go. And Moses is like, God, you got the wrong guy. I'm just not your man. You need to find somebody else, because I'm just not equipped to do that, and I don't want to do it. But God persisted. And so Moses, in the process of trying to get out of it, he says to him in verse 13, he says, if I go to the people of Israel and tell them, the God of your ancestors has sent me to you, they will ask me, what is His name? Well, then what should I say to them? And God replied to Moses, I am who I am. Say this to the people of Israel, I am has sent me to you. You go, well, that's really weird. I am? Yeah, here's the crazy thing about it. That's that word, Yahweh. I am? What does it mean? Would you put this down if you have your notes? It means that God absolutely is. That's what it means. Say, what does that mean? That means that this God, nothing made him. Nothing will destroy him. He was, is, and always will be. It means that he is self-sustaining. He doesn't need anything to keep being who he is. It means because of that, he's all-powerful. There is nothing greater or more powerful than he is. You go, is that all wrapped up in that name? Yes! The name is everything. So when God says to Moses, you tell them the I am sent you, he's saying, you tell them that I absolutely am. And there is none other than me. So when the psalmist says, man, listen, those who know your name trust in you. Well, wow, how can that knowing his name produce trust? Because we're talking about a God who always was and always will be. We're talking about a God who is self-sustaining. We're talking about a God that needs nothing to continue to be who he is. We're talking about a God who is all-powerful and needs nothing from you or me. But we need everything from him. Paul tells us even our very breath that we take in comes from this great I am. He is, absolutely is. And when we get a grip on his name, it begins to produce a trust. You can trust a God who's always there, who doesn't need anything. You can trust that kind of a God. You can trust this Yahweh. So know his name. That's one way that we can learn to trust him. Know his character. Know his character. We don't have time to go through all the attributes of God. There's many of them. But I want to give you three that I believe are the most important for you if you're going to grow in your trust. And here's the first one. And we take this so for granted, but we're going to talk about it just for a second. God is love. Now, you've heard me say this before. God does not have love. He is love. Say, I can back that up. 1 John 4:8, it says, God is love. 1 John 4:16 says, God is love. It doesn't say contains it, has it, possesses it. He is that. See, what does that mean? That means that love comes from the source, and that is God. His very core is love. He can't do anything but love. Do you realize that? Here's where it gets crazy. You go, wait a minute. God judges people, doesn't he? Is that very loving? God's even loving in his judgment. So how can that possibly be? How can God send some people to hell and let other people go to heaven? Oh, see, we've just in that statement, we've gotten things confused. God sends no one to hell. God gives us a choice. He says, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man gets to the Father except through me, right? He gives us the pattern, the formula to get out of hell. And the worst thing about hell is that God's not there. It's separation from God for an eternity. So when we choose anything but God's best, his plan to save us from our sin, if we choose anything else, we're choosing against God. We're saying, God, I don't want your plan. And really, if we don't want his plan, we're not trusting him. So we're really not even believing in this God. We're believing in some God that we've made up on our own. And we're saying, God, I don't really want your plan. I don't really want you. And God in his love says, okay, if you don't want me, I'm not going to force you to have me. And so since you've chosen to not be with me, I will give you what you have chosen. See, God is not going to force somebody to be in his presence forever who doesn't want to be in his presence. That's not love. Even in God's judgment, even in God's the way that he deals with us, it's love. It's at his very core. In his love, he always wills what's best. Man, this is so important. In God's love, he always wills what's best. God wants, listen, not good for you. He wants best for you. Do you understand that? God doesn't want to just give you good. He wants to give you best. You say, what does that look like? God, he's the best. I mean, if everything good comes from God, then he's got to be the best. And God wants best for you and me. See, the enemy comes along and says, God doesn't have your best in mind. God, he's just giving you all these rules because he's trying to flex his cosmic muscles and make himself just, you know, be the man. So don't listen to him. Do it your own way because your way is going to be more fun. It's going to be more everything. Just don't listen to him. And the enemy gets us to think that God is holding out on us and that he doesn't have best for us. But that goes totally against his character. If God is love, he always wills the best. Man, get this, because this is so vital. Because when God says, hey, here's a command for you, it's backed up by his character of love. That command is for not just your good, your best. Say, can I trust that? Can you trust this kind of a God who at his very core is love? Here's the second character I want to point out. The second characteristic of God is wise. He's wise. Proverbs 3:19 says, by wisdom the Lord founded the earth. By understanding he created the heavens. Do you realize if we were just a very short distance closer to the sun, we would burn up? If we were just a very short distance away from the sun, we would freeze. Do you realize that God has placed everything just right on this planet for life? And so far, we've not found life on any other planet. Say, well, they think they found frozen water on Venus or wherever it is. Well, that's fine. But have they found this? Have they found this? See, some scientists call Earth, get this. This is a pretty interesting title. The privileged planet. And the reason they call it the privileged planet is because they look at it and they go, you know, out of all the other places that we had so far have been able to explore, everything here, get this, is just right for life. It is tuned just right. We are a privileged planet. Where does that come from? Proverbs 3:19 says, by wisdom the Lord founded the earth. By understanding he created the heavens. Jeremiah 10:12, but the Lord made the earth by his power and he preserves it by his wisdom. So God's character is wise. And you say, well, how does wisdom point to his trustworthiness? In his wisdom, he always knows what's best. In his love, he always wills what's best. In his wisdom, he always knows what's best. We go, man, why does God bring this into my life? Because you may not understand it, but he knows what's best. It's kind of like our children, right? As parents, we do things they don't get. They think we're the worst parents in the whole. And get ready, Kenny and Brianna. It hasn't happened yet because he thinks you're God right now, Kenny. And we all know that's not true. But someday, you're going to make some decision and he's going to think you're the worst guy in the world and you don't know what's best for me. Because, see, we've all been there, haven't we, if we're honest. But as a parent, we have a different perspective and we have a different viewpoint. And because of our wisdom of years and experience, we know that what this child wants to do is not in their best interest. And so even though they don't understand it, and even though they may hate me because of it, I'm going to stick with my guns because I want best for this child that I love. And my wisdom says that I'm going to do this because it is the best outcome for them. That's God. In his wisdom, he always knows what's best. And the last characteristic I want to point out to you this morning is that God is sovereign. He's sovereign. Isaiah 46:9 says this, and this is God speaking. He says, "Remember the things I have done in the past, for I alone am God. I am God, and there's none like me. Only I can tell you the future before it even happens. Everything I plan will come to pass, for I do whatever I wish." Now, that's a dangerous thing. If you put that statement into a being that's not perfect and loving to do whatever he wishes, that's a dangerous thing. But we're talking about an all-loving, all-wise God who says, "I'm in complete control and I do whatever I wish. There's no God but me." That's sovereignty, folks. 1 Chronicles 16:31. "Let the heavens be glad and the earth rejoice. Tell all the nations, the Lord reigns." Man, we better be glad that he does. Because his character is all loving. He's all wise. And that's the kind of God you want in control. Because get this. Because of his love, he always wills what's best. Because of his wisdom, he always knows what's best. Because of his sovereignty, he has the power to bring about the best. See how that works? So we look at this and we go, wow, okay, well, I see that there's enough knowledge here about God that he can be trusted. But we have to go one step further. Gathering knowledge about God and coming to the conclusion that he can be trusted is good, but the question really is, can you trust him? It's not just about looking at it and saying, wow, this God is all loving, he's good, he's also wise, he's also sovereign, which means he's powerful. His name tells us that he's beyond us, he's self-sustaining, he's self-existent. We can see that God is all these things, and man, it seems to me like he's trustworthy. But the question is, will you trust him? See, we're back at that personal aspect of this thing again. Let's suppose that you found out that you needed some kind of serious surgical procedure. And you sit down with your family doctor, and your family doctor recommends a particular surgeon to you. Well, I mean, I'm sure that there's a number of us in here that would say, "Thank you very much, doctor. I would like to research this surgeon a little bit." And you want to know what this surgeon's all about, because this is a serious procedure, and you don't want just anybody cutting on your body. You don't want to just stick your life into anybody's hands. And so you begin to do your research, and you find out that this surgeon graduated from one of the top medical schools in the country. And that's impressive, but the thing that next impresses you is you find out that this surgeon graduated at the top of their class with the highest honors. And then as you continue to do your research on this surgeon, you discover that he's received numerous awards because of excelling in the surgical procedures that he does. And on top of that, you discover that he's done over 3,000 of these types of surgeries, never having a failure. Well, now you've gathered this information and you go, wow, this guy's impressive. This guy has the credentials. You found out that he's thorough, that he's meticulous, and he's very successful. And you go, this guy, he's trustworthy. But you still have to decide whether you are going to trust him with the surgical procedure on you. He may have all the credentials and he may come out looking very trustworthy, but you finally have to make the decision whether you are going to trust him with that procedure. And that's where we're at. So see, as we learn to trust, it's important that we gather as much information and know this God as we can. But here's number two. You can learn to trust God as your relationship with him grows. See, not only is trust built on knowledge, but it's also built on relationship. So let's go back to our illustration about the surgeon. So let's suppose you find out all this stuff about the surgeon. Great school, top of the class, honors, no failures. This guy's trustworthy, but let's change our story a little bit. This surgeon also happens to be your best friend. See, now you have the knowledge that this guy's good, that this guy has the credential, but you also have a relationship that enhances that knowledge. Now you're going, wow, this guy not only knows his stuff, but because of my relationship with him, I think he's going to be extra careful when he cuts me open and he starts pulling stuff out of my body. Right? Relationship enhances my trust. Let me read you, and this is familiar for most of us that have been around the church, even if you haven't been around the church in a long time, somewhere along the way you've heard this passage, but this passage exemplifies what I'm talking about. Listen to this. The Lord is my shepherd. I have all that I need. He lets me rest in green meadows. He leads me beside peaceful streams. He renews my strength. He guides me along right paths, bringing honor to his name. Even when I walk through the darkest valley, I will not be afraid, for you are close beside me. Your rod and your staff protect and comfort me. You prepare a feast for me in the presence of my enemies. You honor me by anointing my head with oil. My cup overflows with blessing. Surely your goodness and unfailing love will pursue me all the days of my life, and I will live in the house of the Lord forever. The word trust doesn't show up once in that psalm. But that poetic picture screams trust. The sheep and the shepherd, the relationship. And as David writes that psalm, he's saying, man, God, you are my shepherd. You provide these things for me. I trust you even when I go through the darkest valley. You see how relationship changes that whole picture, the whole desire to trust. And so if you and I want to learn to trust this God that we say we believe in, yeah, gather knowledge, know his name, know his character, but grow in relationship with him. How do I do that? Like any other relationship, you spend time with him. That's what prayer is all about. Prayer is me talking to God. It's no special language, no special format. It's just you dumping on God and talking to God. And then, get this, listening to him answer you back. Say, does God do that? Yeah. A lot of times he does it right here. That's why we call it God's word. Sometimes he does it through other people. Sometimes he whispers into the ear of your spirit. God speaks. And as you spend time with him and you build that relationship, guess what? You're going to naturally trust him more because he becomes your best friend. So, I can learn to trust God by gaining knowledge about who he is, by growing in my relationship with him, and here's number three. You can learn to trust God as you experience his trustworthiness in your life. I know that's kind of a mouthful, But let me use our illustration again. We're going to change it a little bit one more time. So you find out that you need this surgery, and so you do all this research on this surgeon because you don't want just anybody cutting on your body. You don't want anybody just doing surgery on you. And so you find out all these things about him that demonstrate that he is trustworthy. He knows his stuff. He knows what he's doing. But even better than that, this surgeon happens to be your very best friend. And so you know, based on that relationship, there's even more of a reason that you can trust him. But now is where we change our story just a little bit, because this surgeon has done some other procedures on you in the past and has always done well in those procedures. Oh, this one right now that you're facing is a really big one. It's not quite like the other ones, but because he's done these other procedures on you, this guy that's really qualified, this guy that's your best friend, and this guy who has always done right for you by the procedures he's done in the past, now you have even built that much more reason to trust this surgeon. See, that's God, folks. See, you gather the information about him, you begin to know him, about him in a deeper and a better way, and you begin to build your relationship with him as you spend time with him and as you get to know him personally a little bit more. And then as that grows, you go through life's experiences and he gives you these little things where you have to trust him. And you do, and he gets you through and you go, wow, he is trustworthy. And then something else comes up and you got to trust him again. And he gets you through that and you go, wow, he really came through on that one. And they get a little bigger each time. And it reminds me of the story of Abraham. God shows up in Abraham's life in Genesis 22, and he says, Abraham. And Abraham replies, yes, here I am. God says, take your son, your only son, yes, Isaac, whom you love so much, and go to the land of Moriah. Go and sacrifice him as a burnt offering on the mountains, which I will show you. God comes to Abraham, he says, I want you to take your son, your only son, and I want you to go kill him? Well, if you know the story, you know that Abraham doesn't question it. He gets his son, he gets a couple of servants, and they take off for this place where he's going to sacrifice him. And you go, what? Is this guy nuts? See, here's the thing. I brought you into chapter 22. What you don't know, if you're not familiar with the story, is that God had been working with Abraham for decades. He took Abraham into these life experiences where Abraham had to make a choice whether he would trust God or not. And on some occasions, Abraham trusted God, and it always turned out good. On other occasions, he didn't trust God. He took matters into his own hands, and he always screwed it up. But see, literally decades have gone by before this story, and Abraham has had choice after choice in life experience after life experience where he has learned that this God, he's trustworthy. This God who's telling me to do this thing that I don't understand, I know based on past experience that he's never let me down, that I can always trust him. See, you got to get to that point with that surgeon where you say, okay, I'm going to trust you. I'm going to trust you even when I go under anesthesia and I can't see what you're doing. I don't think anybody in here would say, yeah, you know what, I want open heart surgery, but don't give me any of that anesthesia stuff. I'm keeping my eye on you, buddy, while you operate. No, I'm saying give me as much as you can. If I can stay asleep through the whole healing process, great, that's even better, right? But what are we saying? We're saying to that surgeon, man, I trust you, knock me out. I don't have to see what you're doing. I'm going to trust that you're doing the right thing. See, what happens is you finally get to that point with the surgeon where you say, look, based on my knowledge of you, my relationship with you, and the fact that you've done some things for me before and you've always come through, I'm going to trust you even though I don't really understand what you just said to me because all those medical words went right over my head. But I'm going to trust that you know what you're saying and you know what you're doing. And see, that's what happens when we come to God. There's going to be times where you are in the dark. God, I can't see you. I don't know where you're at, and I don't know what you're doing. But see, if that knowledge and that relationship and those experiences have brought you to the place where you've learned to trust, then you can trust him even when you don't see what's going on. God, there's some stuff here I just don't understand. God, you are way bigger than me, and I don't get this, but God, because I know you and I have this relationship with you and I've seen you come through for me time and time again, God, I'm going to trust you even though I don't understand this. And see, we learn trust. It doesn't just happen. We learn it. Yes, yes. When you came to Christ, some of you have trusted Christ as your Lord and Savior this morning. That's great. And when you did that, that was your introduction into trust. It's the beginning of your trust, but that trust has to grow. And you've got to learn bigger and better ways to trust God. And he'll come through and ask you to trust him in stuff where you can't see him, where you don't understand him. But you got to believe him. And it's not just a shot in the dark. Remember, we have these reasonable evidences to believe that he's there. And now, since we know his word is reliable, we can go to what he's revealed about himself here so that we know more about him. And so that's what builds this opportunity for us to trust him. Jeremiah 17:7 says this, "Blessed are those who trust in the Lord and have made the Lord their hope and confidence." Listen, as you and I go through life's experiences, we're going to be put in these situations where we have a choice. And it really comes down to one of two things. It's really that simple. Will I trust God in this or will I not trust God in this? And it might start off something like this where I come up against a financial situation. I go, man, I don't know how I'm going to get through this. So you got a decision to make. Are you going to rely on yourself? Are you going to try to pull yourself out of this situation? Are you going to look at it and say, God, I can't see, I don't understand, but I know you and I built this relationship with you. And God, I'm going to trust you in this area. And God comes through. And that's an experience where you learn he's trustworthy. I can trust him. But then it might go something deeper the next time around. Next time around, maybe you lose your job. And man, God, where are you, God? Do you know what's going on? And God says, trust me, trust me. It didn't catch me by surprise. You didn't know you were going to lose your job. I knew you were going to lose your job. Trust me. And then we've got a decision to make. Are we going to trust him? And then it may even get deeper than that. Somewhere down the line, we find out that our health, we've got some major serious health issue. And we go before God and we go, God, I don't understand. God, why is this happening? And why am I going through this? And God doesn't give us the answer. He just says, trust me. Trust me. Do you know who I am? Do you know my name? Do you know my character? Have you built a relationship with me? Have you seen me walk you through the experiences of your life? Trust me. Trust me. And we're going to have to make a decision whether we're going to trust him or not. And see, that's why what we've been going over is so important, because trust isn't just hanging out in the air somewhere. It's built on strong and tangible evidence. And I've got to come to a point where I say, okay, I'm going to trust you here, God. He's worthy of your trust. The greatest act of trust in God anyone can demonstrate is putting their trust in him for their salvation. John 3:16, right? For God so loved the world that he gave his only son, that whoever believes in him, trusts in him, will have everlasting life. You go, Rand, that's a great verse. I've heard that before. That's great, man. If I put my trust in what Jesus did on the cross for me, I can have my sins forgiven? Yeah, that's what that's saying. How can I believe that? Well, listen. There is reasonable evidence to believe that there's a God. Design shows us, moral law shows us that there is a God. And if there's a God, guess what? Miracles are possible. The greatest miracle of all would be creation. And if God is God and He can create, then God sending His Son to take the form of a man, live a perfect life, die on a cross to pay the penalty and punishment for our sin, rise again from the dead to prove that His life was valid, His message was valid, and that His payment on the cross was valid. If miracles are possible, then yeah, that's possible. You say, where do you get all that? I get it out of this book that we've discovered is reliable, that I can rely on this. So John 3:16, for God so loved you that He gave His only Son, that if you trust in Him, you'll have everlasting life. Can you believe that? I'm here to tell you that's a trustworthy statement because it's given by a trustworthy God. You can trust Him. You can trust Him. We've got to learn to trust Him. Amen. Would you bow your heads, please?